Welcome to Storytime Science at the Exploratorium. My name is Viv, and this is the Halloween episode, but it's also the sound and vibration episode. We're going to be reading a book, Skulls, by Blair Thornburgh, illustrated by Scott Campbell, and we're going to be doing three kind of spooky activities. We're going to be doing head harp, the creaking door, and the haunted rice. So let's get reading. Skulls. You probably don't think much about skulls. But every head of every person you've ever seen has a skull inside, and that's a good thing. Skulls take a while to grow strong and hard, but it's time well spent. Skulls are safe and snug, like a car seat for your brain. Skulls give your face a good shape. Skulls let your jaws snap. Skulls hold your teeth in place, until they don't. Skulls have holes in them. So a hole, eyes. Hole and hole, ears. Hole, nose. Hole, mouth. For sounds. For light. For air. For grilled cheese sandwiches. Skulls don't have noses, but skulls don't really need noses. They're more of a cartilage thing. But most of all, skulls are not trying to be scary. They can't help the way they look. They just do their job, and no one says thank you. And some people are even afraid of them. But not you at all. You love having a safe place to keep your brain. You snap your jaws with gusto, and you love having teeth in your mouth. Until, of course, you lose them. They'll grow back. You love having holes for hearing, for seeing, for smelling and breathing, and for eating grilled cheese sandwiches. So tell your friends, nice skull. It gives your face a good shape. Tell your family, thanks for helping my skull grow strong and hard. Shout to the world, I love my skull. Take care of your skull, because you only get one. And think of how amazing it is to have such good bones in your body. Okay, time for our spooky Halloween science activities. We have three activities. And I'd also like to introduce my assistant, Jack. He will be here with us. He'll maybe be able to help out, but I'm not so sure. Our first activity is called Head Harp. And all you need for this is a piece of string, and you probably want to use slightly thicker string like twine, and you also need an assistant. If there's a grown-up around your house, they make particularly good assistants. So try that. I'm going to pretend like I'm two different people because I'm just one person. What you need to do is you're going to put the string around the back of your head, and you are going to cover both of your ears. So put your hands over your ears. The assistant will hold the string in place. And while you have your hands over your ears, the assistant will pluck this like it was a guitar string. This is your skull at work. What might you hear inside your head if you have something that's vibrating your skull like this string? This is called head harp. It's a good activity for your skull, for you and your skull. This is a sound effect science activity. So, first thing you want to do is you want a plastic cup. You could also use a paper cup. And a ballpoint pen is good for this because you want to very, very carefully poke a hole in the bottom of the cup. I put my hand all the way in the cup so I could sort of hold the bottom of the cup in place. This would be easier if you're using a paper cup. And you just want to make a small hole, just about the size of the tip of the ballpoint pen. And this might be a good time to also ask your grown-up assistant to help you out, because they might be better at poking the hole with the ballpoint pen into the bottom of the cup. I already poked the hole in this cup, but you would just put it right there and just poke it through so that you get a small hole. So I already poked a hole in the bottom of this cup. Both plastic. This is a blue one. This is a red one. And the next thing you want to do is you want to take a paper clip and a piece of string. You actually want this thinner than that piece of twine you used for head harp. And not quite as thin as thread, but pretty thin string. And you want to tie it very, very securely to the middle of the paper clip. And maybe tie a double knot so it's nice and secure. So now this is securely tied onto the middle of the paper clip. I'm going to take the other end, the non-paper clip end, and I am going to thread it through that hole in the top of the cup. I'm going to reach in. So there it is at the end of the cup. And the string is nice and secure because the paper clip is not letting it go through the hole. And you might want to even add a little piece of scotch tape just to make extra, extra sure that that paper clip is held in place. So I just added a little piece of tape on the top. All right, now you need a little cup of water because you're going to be dipping your fingers into the water. And you want to make sure that the string is nice and wet. So I'm actually going to wet the string. Okay. And are we ready for the creaking door? It was a dark and stormy night. I heard footsteps outside the door. Suddenly, the door started to open. It opened a little bit more. Who could be on the other side of the door? Was it a ghost? But a ghost wouldn't need to use the door. The ghost would just kind of go right through the door. Oh, it was just my dad with some Halloween candy. The creaking door happens because your fingers, your wet fingers, are sort of stopping and starting and stopping and starting on the string. The string isn't oily. Your fingers aren't oily. And you just get that nice kind of creaking sound. And because it's in the cup, the sound of the friction from your finger pulling on the string echoes inside of the cup. The cup acts as a little echo chamber. And probably the cup itself vibrates a little bit too. Sound is vibration. You're kind of vibrating the string by it stopping and starting as you pull your finger down. And if the cup itself, in addition to the string, is vibrating, that's called sympathetic vibration. If I just pulled on the string, you don't get any creaking sound. You really need that cup to act as an echo chamber. So you could do your whole, like a whole sound effects thing, tell a story and... This third Halloween science activity is called the haunted rice. So I have just some plain rice. It could be brown rice, it could be white rice. The rice is a little bit starchy, which is why we use rice. But it's not cooked, it's raw. And you need a wine glass. Again, you may have to consult with a grown-up assistant for this as well. So I put some grains of rice into the cup with a little bit of water. I already did this. And then I have a spoon. So see, now the rice kernels are a little bit wet, but because rice is kind of starchy, when they get a little bit wet, not cooked, but a little bit wet, they get a little bit sticky. And I'm using this spoon to sort of just smush them up against the sides of the glass. You don't want to use too much rice because you don't want to make the whole glass and rice thing too heavy. But you don't want too few grains of rice either. So there we have the grains of rice stuck against the side of the wine glass. And you need a glass with a stem like this. Now, because you already have a little cup of water, you poured some into the glass to just wet the raw kernels of rice. Now you're going to do that old thing of playing the wine glass kind of like it's a musical instrument. But let's see what happens to the rice when I do that. Is the rice haunted? Maybe it is. I'm going to wet my finger. First of all, I'm going to wash my hands, which you should be doing a lot anyway. But I'm going to wash my hands to make sure that there aren't any natural oils on my hand. And this may take a while to get going, but you're going to hear that nice high bell sound, which again is going to be friction. The rice seems to be haunted because it's shimmying. That sound you hear is vibration. And that vibration is making the whole glass vibrate. And I don't know if the kernels of rice are trying to run away. So there you have it. Head harp using your skull, the creaking door, and the haunted rice. Happy scientific Halloween. Thank you, Jack. Halloween Poetry Corner. This is a very, very short poem called Flutter, Flutter, Little Bat by Leanne Gunther. Flutter, flutter, little bat, how I wonder where you're at. Swooping through the darkest night, you find your way without a light. Flutter, flutter, little bat, how I wonder where you're at. Now, this is really interesting because bats don't see when they fly around in the night. They use something called echolocation. This whole episode has been about Halloween, yes, but also about sound. Bats use sound to see in the dark.